Okay, this is officially your chance. I'm asking for your opinion on the mullet. Is it pot or rot? Hi, it's me, Bussy, and welcome back to my channel. Here we are about a week out from All Stars 7, where RuPaul crowned queen of all queens, Jinkx Monsoon, and a queen of she'd already had hers is Raja. And we are gathered here today not to mourn the death of RuPaul's Drag Race All Stars Season 7, but rather to commemorate its life in a data-driven post-mortem exploration of its reception. To do so, we'll check the pulse of what the fans thought about All Stars 7 by digging through its IMDB reviews, and along the way, we'll calculate All Stars 7's ranked position against its peers, and even dissect the nitty-gritty of how individual episodes rank against the greater RuPaul's Drag Race episodic library from around the world. And you better buckle up because we've got data, spreadsheets, charts, and graphs. But first, is that a Manscaped Lawnmower 4.0 in my pocket, or am I just happy to see you? Actually, both. The Lawnmower 4.0 is an electric, waterproof body hair trimmer you can use in the shower. It's got an LED light so you can hit all the cracks and crevices of your nether regions, multiple trim guard options, and the lawnmower is part of my secret for staying cool and fresh this summer, but it's only the start. Once I've trimmed the hedges, I hit my family jewels with the Crop Preserver Ball Deodorant for all day freshness. And then a spritz or two of the Crop Reviver Ball Toner, which is made with aloe vera to help refresh and soothe. But that's not all. Save even more when you bundle and go all the way with me this summer to get the Platinum Package 4.0. It includes the Weed Whacker ear and nose hair trimmer, their ultra premium shower products, and underarm stick deodorant. Click the link in the description of my video to shop at manscaped.com/bussy. You'll get 20% off your order and free international shipping. Plus, two free gifts when you bundle. The Shed Luxury Leather Travel Bag and Manscaped's Anti-Chafing Boxer Briefs. Remember, manscaped.com/bussy to look, feel, and smell great this summer. Thanks Manscaped for sponsoring today's video. Now let's go ahead and get this legendary analysis all started by pulling some data from IMDB, a media ratings website where users can submit reviews for content like movies and TV shows out of a possible 10 stars. Like this. And I will acknowledge, using IMDB to measure audience perception of a piece of media is not a perfect way to do that, and we'll talk more about the problems with this data at the end of the video, but let's just have fun with what we do have, and that's thousands of user-submitted reviews for the show that we all know and love, RuPaul's Drag Race. To collect our data today, I used a Python web scraping script, which works by visiting the pages of IMDB and pulls off those averaged user ratings on an episodic basis by season and puts them into a cute little spreadsheet. And from there, I did some gay math to calculate a number that I'm calling the average episodic rating, or AER, which is just the average of the average user ratings for every episode in a given season. And I calculated this myself for two reasons. IMDb only shows scores in aggregate across a franchise instead of on a per season basis. And their ratings library includes data for things like the Meet the Queens, early seasons clip shows, and reunion episodes, which I've removed from this new data set to better standardize the data. And drumroll please. All Star 7's IMDb average episodic rating is currently sitting at a shiny 8.45 Legendary Legend stars. And for context, this 8.45 AER is great. Across the 35 completed seasons of RuPaul's Drag Race from around the world, All Star 7 is only beat in this ranking by All Stars 2, Espana 1, and Espana 2, which have AERs of 8.85, 8.57, and 8.53 respectively. It's the fourth highest ranked completed Drag Race season in the IMDb database, and the second highest ranked US-based season. And filling in the rest of our top 10 here, we've got US seasons 6 and 5, UK seasons 2 and 1, US season 9, and then All Stars 6, which is actually tied for ranking position number 10 with US season 4. And for further frame of reference, because we would not have tops without bottoms, the bottom 5 of our ranking list includes US season 13, UK versus the World, Holland 1, Down Under 1, and Holland 2 in that order, with AERs ranging 6.75 to 5.5. But back to All Star 7, what comprises that 8.45 legendary star rating? At the top of the episodic ranking list in the All Star 7 season, we have Snatch Game, with an average user score of 9.8 stars, which is not only a top in this season, but an extremely high rating across all 363 episodes in my dataset. The 9.8 episodic score is shared only by Espana 2's talent show. And for some more context here, the next highest rated episode in this dataset belongs to All Stars 2 Shoes episode 5, where Alyssa and Tatiana lip sync to Shut Up and Drive. Its user rating, by the way, is 9.6 stars, which I heavily disagree with. It deserves all 10 stars. It is my favorite moment in Drag Race history. All-Star 7's best rated episode, The Snatch Game, with 9.8 stars, was exceptional. But the crazy thing is, the Legends premiere episode and Roast have 9.3 and 9.4 stars, respectively. And having this many highly rated episodes in itself is legendary. There are only 13 seasons out of our 35 that have a single episode rated over 9 stars, and only 6 other seasons that have more than one episode rated over 9 stars. All-Stars 2, Espana 2, and All-Star 7 share a 3-way tie for having 3 episodes rated over 9 stars, and the crown holder here is Espana Season 1 with 4 episodes rated over 9 stars. However, all 3 of All-Star 7's episodes rated over 9 stars crack the top 6 ranked positions of all episodes, and 10 of its 12 episodes appear in the top 1/3 of our episodic ranking. We have The Realness of Fortune Ball at position 38, tied with the Draguation Speeches episode, then Legendary Legend Looks at position 50, Dance Like a Drag Queen at position 66, and Fairy Tale Justice at 96. At the bottom of this top third, we have Total Request Live and Santa's School for Girls sharing a tied position at 116 with a star rating of 8.10. I know what you're thinking. What's with all the ties in this episodic ranking list? And the actual reason is because the data scraped from IMDb is rounded to the 10th place, which is not a very live, laugh, love thing of the IMDb people to do, but I suppose it's fine? All-Star 7's 2 Ugly Stepchildren are the Lollapalooza lip sync smackdown for the crown, rated at 7.8 stars, which sits at ranking position 172, but it still means this episode is ranked in the top 50% of all Drag Race episodes ever. And the worst rated episode from All-Star 7, according to IMDb, is The Variety Show, which is not only low for this season, but also low in comparison with the entire episodic library. It sits at position number 324, tied with Down Under's Snatch Game. And y'all are wrong for that. That's wrong. But it is impressive that this season managed to have one of the best and worst rated episodes across the entire franchise. It truly was the best of times, and the worst of times. But generally speaking, I think the IMDb ratings do a pretty good job of capturing fan sentiment, despite an inability to capture nuance. For example, the All-Star 7 variety show was, I think, the best variety show we've ever seen. And evaluating this episode through that lens makes this IMDb user rating really confusing? But I think its low IMDb rating reflects the unhappiness fans had with the twists introduced this episode, and someone who did not like the outcome of the top 4, I would propose, is likely to rate this episode quite low, despite the TV or challenge itself actually being good. IMDb ratings being nothing more than a temperature check of fan sentiment, though, is also evident in the actual episodic user ratings. The variety show received 270 votes of 10 stars and 265 votes for 1 star. The Lollapalooza episode received 223 votes for 10 stars and 111 for 1 star. These ratings are basically just fans going onto this website and clicking thumbs up or thumbs down, while a more serious critical rating of RuPaul's Drag Race seasons would consider much, much more than if someone was happy with an outcome. It's also worth noting this data does have some inherent problems. Users can submit reviews for episodes at any time, even if they've not watched them, and submitting a rating is as simple as a click. And while a sufficient large number of respondents should solve for problems like this, the truth is the sample size for these episodes is kind of small when compared to the amount of people that actually watch Drag Race. I mentioned at the beginning of the video that this data set across every season includes almost 130,000 votes, but that number starts to seem small when we take a look at the average votes per season of Drag Race. All-Star 7 received 10,841 votes across its 12 episodes, and the average number of votes received per episode comes out to about 903. And generally speaking, earlier seasons have less votes overall. For example, All-Stars 1 received 1,317 votes across its 6 episodes, averaging 219 per episode, and US Season 7 received 3,164 votes, averaging about 243 votes across its 13 episodes in this dataset. So whether the data is getting more reliable because more people are voting over time, can't really say. But interestingly, we do see episodic ratings hit higher highs and lower lows as time moves forward and amount of votes cast increases. In addition to there being less centricity in the data as time moves forward, considered, there is also a discernible negative trend line in it. Episodic reviews of Drag Race from around the world are trending slightly more negative. A similar negative trend line is also present in the season-wide AER ratings data when plotted by their premiere air dates over time. And breaking that data out a bit, we see regular US Drag Race seasons are trending more negatively reviewed, while All-Stars seasons are trending more positively reviewed. Combined, though, US and US-based All-Star seasons are trending more negatively reviewed. And the international seasons are trending in the positive direction, albeit not by a lot. But don't look too deeply for meaning in these trends. Instead, let me know what direction you think Drag Race as a franchise is headed in the comments below. Tell me your favorite and least favorite seasons and why. And finally, we'll conclude with the thoughts of my patrons who make my channel possible. I asked them over on patreon.com/bussyqueen, which is my members-only website where they get exclusive benefits like early access to my videos and access to exclusive content, to vote on which episode of All-Star 7 they thought was their favorite, and to give me a star rating for each episode in the season. In terms of my patrons' favorite episode from the season, there's about a 2/3 majority for the Snatch Game. And in terms of average episodic rating, my patrons were a little harsher than the IMDb users, or I should perhaps say more critical. They gave All-Star 7 an average episodic rating of 7.45 stars. And comparing across these two groups, we see their top three episodes are all ranked in the same order, but notably, my Patreon group ranked the Variety Extravaganza way higher. It sits at their rank position number 4, while, if you'll remember, it sits at the very bottom of the IMDb ranking. But that's all the data I have for you today. I also want to say thanks to my patrons who make my channel possible, and give a special shout out to Ash Sundara Kumar, Tracy Gifford, and Misha Washington have all just joined my Patreon at the hot tier. And aid in the individual, Alicia, Angel, Cyrus, Dickie, Felicia, Frankie, Hector, Jeffrey Steinberg, Joseph, Josh, Kyle Hermes, Laura, Lizette, Louis Labrador, Luke Peterson, Mark James, Matthew Burns, Matto, Michelle, Your Bell, Miss F, Neely, Sailor, Steven, Topher, Neely, and Will and Ton, who are all supporting me at my Bussy Queen Collector tier. See y'all later. Love ya. Bye.